please stand and pledge and followed by a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to start out tonight. First, thank everybody for coming. Got a nice crowd here. It's always a pleasure to have some recognition and accomplishments in the corporation at this time. Maria Kelsey and Covenant. Let's tell about what's going on.
I think
I'll sit.
Chris is going to
share the information.
I did what's going on anyway, but I had the privilege to announce that we have a young lady here, Covenant Lingenfelter, who has been selected as an academic all-star in the state of Indiana. There are 250 nominated statewide by building principals, and she was one of 90 selected. So that's quite an honor. It's put on by the Indiana Association of School Principals and the Indianapolis Star. So kind of a really neat thing to have in the community and the school district. And of course, the short time I've been here this year, she's a young lady that certainly stood out. And so seen her active and involved not only in academics, but the school play and various things like that, and has a great voice as well. So with that, she also selected as a teacher of influence, Mrs. Kelsey. And so she's here, and I'm going to let her say a few words about Covenant. So what a great honor.
Okay, thank you. Well, she's extraordinary. When I write recommendations, should I face that way? I'll face this way. And I write a lot of letters of recommendation. I always say something like, it's my pleasure to recommend this student or something. And then I got to Covenant, and I thought, well, all this time I've been saying it's such a pleasure, and I have to say something bigger because she's so much more extraordinary than most of the kids I write letters for. She's smart, and she has an inquiring mind. I think that's what I like best about her. She's very open-minded, and she has very high goals. I don't know, and you should see her in a play. She's amazing. So, Covenant.
Congratulations and thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Jenny Snyder, FCCLA students.
Well, last weekend I took a group of FCCLA students. Those of you who don't know, FCCLA is a club that we do at the high school. It's Family, Career, and Community Leaders of America. And I took a group of them to state conference down in Indianapolis, and we spent 3 days at the Marriott East. And it was definitely the best ever. I've been doing this 6 years, and my group was amazing. They put so much effort into their projects. And we had 2 gold medals. I brought one of the gold medal groups with me, Jamie Meyer and Maya Ferris. And they did a life event planning project that required them to plan an event from start to finish, including doing cost comparisons and spreadsheets, putting it all together in a portfolio and actually presenting it for 10 minutes to a panel of 3 judges. This is a nationally affiliated club, so we had Kinley Lingenfelter that got a gold and then also qualified for nationals. So that's a summer program. This year it's in Washington, D.C. So I'm just really proud of these girls. They did an amazing job. They worked really hard, and they showed that it's really a true leadership club.
Thank you.
And we have one more to add at this time, Troya.
I'm more honored. I'm the director of Triac at the high school, and we aren't asking for recognition, we're actually asking for your help. I have Callie Adams and Saray Carpenter with me tonight to ask you a question.
Okay. All right, well, I'm Callie, and I'm currently in Triumph this year, and we are asking to be able to add Sunday practices between now and the play, which is April 17th and 18th, and so those dates would be
29th, 5th, and 12th.
The 29th, 5th, and 12th for 2 hours?
2 to 3 hours.
At most. And we're asking this because due to the weather and the wonderful winter that we've all had, we've lost about 2.5 weeks of practice, which puts us behind 8 practices. And if you have ever had to memorize lines and blockings and everything else for a play, it's kind of difficult to do. And so asking this, it would help due to, we can't have practices over spring break due to half of the cast being gone the first week, the other half being gone the next week. And if we were to postpone the play dates, we would then have to work around other schedules and also parents asking off and other things.
With the Sunday dates, they're not going to be mandatory. They're just open practice for those who can come, and hopefully it'll be a majority of the cast. And we'd like them to be like 4 to 7 or as late as we can so that people can spend church with their family and spend as much time as they can during their Sunday. And we just need as much time as we can to catch up on the play since we want to keep it on track.
Well, you answered my question, because my next question was going to be, would it be mandatory that everybody, and that would be a hardship for anybody, but you said it's not mandatory.
It's just an open practice for those.
But you hope they all come. Anybody else have any questions?
What's the play?
Robin Hood.
Do we need to take action?
We can, what do you think, board?
What's the time of practice?
As long as we can.
What time of the day on Sunday would your practice be?
What would be the latest we would be allowed to practice on a Sunday?
4 to 7, 5 to 8,
something like that.
Are you ready to close
something? Yeah, I'm fine with that. Okay. I think they're coming because this would be different than our normal policies, and that they're asking for Sunday activities, which I know we've always tried to keep that sacred for family time, and this is one of those exceptions that they're coming to you for. I don't know if it would be better if there are evening church services that some might be concerned about, if a mid-afternoon, if that's a discussionable, I'm not sure.
Well, there's a lot less churches that have Sunday evening services than used to be. However, one of those Sundays is Easter Sunday, which is a big family day after church. But and so if the practices were to start later in the afternoon, that would actually be a good thing, I think.
But that's just my Easter opinion. They just said the 29th, 15th, and 12.
29th, 15th?
Yeah.
Fifth. Oh, never mind. I think you're right. I thought you said 15th. Yeah.
So a later time in the afternoon to start, at least in my opinion, would be a good thing. And there's not much difference between 7 and 8 o'clock in the evening, as far as I'm concerned, either.
So you'd probably be flexible with all the students,
yes.
Get their opinions.
I'm sure we would take a poll as to which time frame would work best for them and their families.
Make a motion to allow and try up. We have any stipulations?
I would make a motion that because of the hardship of this year, and that this is an exception, that they be allowed to go ahead and practice during either one of the time frames that they said, or even extended a little bit. That's fine with me. That's my motion.
Okay.
Awesome.
Okay. Motion by Don, second by Sandy. Any other discussion? All in favor, right?
I have a question.
I got a family member in the play. I'll probably abstain.
Oh, okay.
Mine do too.
Yeah,
all right. But yeah, I made the
most. There's no financial interest for the children involved.
Yeah. All right.
You can abstain if you wish, but there's
you don't have a cameo appearance. Do you?
No.
You're not getting on the Sunday. It's like
I'm sure we can write something in.
No problem. I'm good.
Okay. All in favor, right in. Okay. Motion carries 6-0.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you. Good luck. And at fifth, yes, at this time, if you'd like to leave, that's... Okay, consent items. Certification of February 16th executive session, minutes of the February 16th regular meeting, minutes of the March 4th study session. Any additions or corrections? If not, need a motion to approve?
So moved.
Okay, motion by Jenny, second by Sandy. Any discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Okay, motion carries 6-0. Sherry, financial report.
All right, things are going good. We again have some things for our health care reform, which we all know as Obamacare. I went to a meeting. We have some new reporting requirements for 2015 with IRS codes 6055 and 6056. More or less, what we have to do is you have to track every employee, all their dependents, all their personal information, their monthly premiums, any changes they make to any of their deductions or change their benefits, their hours, leaves, etc. It just comes a big thing on retracking, because at the end of the year, besides a W-2, you're also going to give them another form with all this information on it. So we also need to keep our eyes on the taxes and the fees that we know that come along with this for budgeting. And we also have to start thinking about budgeting for the Cadillac tax that starts in 2018 if there's no changes made. This figure is based on a threshold. It's like your premium, your HRAs, anything that's pre-taxable, and they have like a threshold. You meet that. Then there's a tax. Some are saying it's going to be like around 40%. It's a huge amount of money that will also be taxed on that you'll have to pay also. So it's how it's looking right now, it looks like we might hit it in 2019. It kind of goes off and raises. So we'll just have to keep an eye on that and start budgeting and watching for that. We are working with Frank from MG Insurance and Anthem, and we have a meeting with them on Wednesday. So we're staying on top of it and stuff. I just thought I'd let you guys know that that's something too coming down the on the line with the Obamacare. Okay. Claims for approval are voucher numbers 6398 to 6569, totaling $1,131,665.12. Payroll for approval are the pays of February 20th and March 6th, totaling $788,576.66. And then down to our cash balances in our general fund at the end of February 2015, we have $1,106,970. At the end of February in 2014, we had $1,074,271. So we are seeing a little bit of a savings still. Our cash balance in our capital projects at the end of this month, February 2015, was $66,628. And a year ago in February, it was $236,117. So we're seeing a little bit of our decrease that we're receiving in our capital projects. Cash balance in our transportation at the end of February this year is $769,391. A year ago, it was $657,973. So we're still doing okay in there. Our cash balance for our self-insurance fund at the end of this February this year was $221,495. A year ago, it was negative $60,499. So we're doing pretty good in that with our claims and stuff.
Okay. Any questions? Thank you, Sherry.
You're welcome.
If not, I'll need a motion to approve the financial report, claims, and fund report.
I move that we approve the financial reports.
Okay.
Second.
Okay, a motion by Steve, second by Brad. Any discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Motion carries 6-0. Okay. Student stakeholder focus. Several donations. Rochester Telephone Company, the use of the bucket truck and the personnel to hang new cameras in the parking lot. Rochester High School prom photo booth. Soria Strength and Fitness, $150. The Athletics Optimus Club, $400. Fulton County Community Foundation, Tom Wilson Memorial. To the National Junior Honor Society, Washington DC trip, $2,100. And also VFW Post 1343 to the same trip, Washington DC, the National Junior Leaders. Washington DC trip for, well, it was $900 in that one. Okay, any questions on those? If not, any motion to accept the donations? Yeah.
Tom, I might make a comment. The optimist line item here is a little vague. Several years ago, Dan may remember better than I do, the school started making about $400 available to each of the schools just to help out students who had special needs or problems, coats, eyeglasses, whatever. Found out that the schools either aren't using them or don't need it or something, but we were talking to one of the coaches about the need for some of the students to get practice packs. And we know that they can work to earn them, but there's also some students that just need an additional handout. So they've transferred that $400 to Ryan for the purpose of getting students into athletics. So we think that'll work well for the organizations.
Okay. That's good to know. Thank you, Chad.
I think there was a big run on alarm clocks at the middle school. The nurse there was finding students being tardy, so she purchased some alarm clocks with Optimus Club money, so we're getting our students there on time now.
I think the transfer to athletics is a really neat endeavor on your part, but it also says a lot about the community, because now the coats, the shoes, those types of things are coming from local churches, from private donors, from families. So we're continuing to get the clothes, the hats, the coats that the students need, and now we can branch out into another area. And I just appreciate the community doing that. And as far as eyeglasses and dental care, we found individual insurance that we can carry on those to help those students and families. So I think that we're meeting all of the needs. This is just a great way to get people involved and get them going. Mm-hmm. So thank you.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, right? Motion carries 6-0. I'd like to thank all of them for the donations. Consideration of the F1 application.
We need to do the overnight field trip here first.
Oop, we jumped right over that one. JAG State Career Development overnight field trip to Ivy Tech in Annapolis. And you have that in your packet.
Chris, do you have specific information in regards to that, Brenda's request for JAG?
That, I do not. I looked at that and I thought, I don't have specifics on that.
I know she's requesting to take three students to the state conference, and that they've been doing a tremendous job. I think that Brenda does a really nice job getting those students out, getting them exposed, getting them involved in different conferences and competitions. And this is just one of those culminations that I think that those students deserve that opportunity to attend and gather more information in regards to that. And she's done a nice job filling out this proposal that you have there.
I did talk with her today in the hallway. We was talking about the success of these three students that they recently had, and how she had a real strong desire to kind of keep that going in the students and keeping them really interested. And so I know that this is a part of that, and these are the kind of students that can really benefit from that.
It's a great experience for them. Yeah. It's a great program for them.
I can kind of quickly run through on the application. The major place to be visited will be Ivy Tech campus and Indianapolis State Career Development Conference. JAG prepares students to be life and career ready. This competition directly relates to the JAG competencies. Let's see, they will be learning healthy competition, build self-esteem, practice real life scenarios. And let's see, did we have the name? Emily Hines, Jana Kuhn, Austin
Chilsky.
Yeah. Okay. All right, any other questions? Motion to approve the overnight field trip.
So moved.
I didn't, Brad, Steve, Brad, okay. Second? Sandy? Any other questions? All in favor, right hand. Okay, motion carries, six zero.
It's odd when Sandy's at a loss for words.
Now we'll consider the F1 application.
We had an individual teacher request in regards to an F1 application. We talked about this a little bit at our study session, and then there were additional questions and concerns that came forward. And Chris has had a little bit of experience, I think, with F1 applications, so I'll lean on him a little bit. Dr. Brubaker shared with me that he believed in years past that the board did approve trying to pursue an F1 application. What that is an extension on a foreign exchange student so that they would be allowed to come back and continue education here within the district. It was my understanding, he was under the impression that the board accepted that, but that the process to receive the okay to move forward can take up to 9 months and that they don't make any exceptions. At that time, it was too difficult for that student, and moving them in, it would have been near the end of the year, mid-year, and it wasn't a viable opportunity at that point for him, so it kind of went by the wayside. He was under the impression that the school did pass the security checks and everything was in line, that we would have been accepted. It just didn't work out for that particular family. I worked with the individual family that's making this request for the student. They are still interested in pursuing it, even if it takes that 9 months. They still wanted to look into it. They are willing to help incur the cost of receiving the F1 application, as well as the funds that it would take to educate that student going forward, because we don't receive the state reimbursement for those students. Adam Strasser shared today, and Chris, I'll lean on you a little bit. There is concern with the IHSAA eligibility. They are only eligible for 1 year. So even if they do decide to come back, it would be for educational purposes only. They would not qualify for the IHSAA. And if the board decides to move forward, we can reserve the right to interview the families, interview the students, interview the prospective home families here to make a determination before acceptance. So I think it could be a great opportunity for some of our students, and then it also helps align if some of our students wanted to study abroad. It would help with that alignment, getting them in schools where they may want to go.
Any questions? So the corporation wouldn't have the right to screen applicants.
If that's the way that we decide to move forward and process that, absolutely. We could reserve the right to interview the student, the local family, as well as the family from the student who may be coming, you know, their biological family.
Other questions?
Are we looking at this primarily as an extension of our foreign exchange students who have already chosen to be here?
Typically, that's the way it happens. As they come, they really appreciate the experience, they enjoy the educational opportunities, they start to bond with the family.
It typically, my experience in the past with students such as this, not always, but many of them come from pretty well-to-do families, so money a lot of times is not an option, or not an obstacle with them. So I believe it's quite expensive, $9,000 to $10,000 you're looking per student. So usually if they're pushing it, they probably have the wherewithal to help finance that, if not completely finance it.
And I think our students benefit from it as well. It's a cultural exchange that we can all benefit from.
Yeah. Would be junior and senior year.
They could, if we get the F1, it's junior, senior year.
You mean for this instance or for all?
I believe it's for all.
Do you wish to have approval, because we're not sure if it was approved before, do you want approval now?
Yep, we did approve it.
You did approve it?
We did.
Well, we do it again.
Yeah, Linda tried to do some research and we couldn't find anything solid on it. Deanne remembered conversations, Dr. Brubaker remembered conversations, but we can't find any of the application process or the notes where in documentation that we had the permission to do that.
I guess
we did search for it.
I would like, if we approve it this time, make sure the screening process is in it. It may not have been the first time.
Okay.
So that would be different. We did something like that. Any questions?
During our discussion prior to this, it seemed like someone said that we have to accept a student who applies.
We weren't sure at that time.
We weren't sure at that.
But we have done a lot of research, and we know now.
We do not have to.
No.
Okay.
And we can limit numbers if it becomes a concern with class load, those types of things, we can limit the number.
Thank you.
So we do have control over it.
We do.
Motion?
I move that we proceed with applying to be an F1 school with the stipulation that the corporation has the right to screen families, or I should say will screen families, not just the right to screen, and students.
And you also said that they were going to pay for this?
Yeah, they would have to incur the cost. We would have to make that.
That's really something.
Otherwise, we would incur a huge cost to the district.
And if that needs to be part of the motion, then yes, with the understanding that the student is responsible for their full tuition cost.
Have a second?
I second that.
Motion by Jenny, second by Steve. Any other discussion? All in favor, write in, please. Okay, motion carries 6-0.
We've got it this time, in the back.
Okay, personnel report. We have spring air session coming up. We have Kylie Daig at Columbia, Bethany Sewell, Columbia, Megan Gongwer, Columbia, Amber Reinholt, Columbia IA, Brittany Piercy at Riddle, Mona Zion Riddle, Angie Smith Riddle, Tammy Paul, Rochester Middle School Language Arts, Chris Cox, RMS Math, Ken Hughes, RMS, I don't know what's he, Ken, we don't have any.
He typically does the math remediation
math,
part.
Okay. And Deb Wolford, RHS Math, and Felix Anayano, RHS Language Arts. Then we have, for the enrichment that's going on, would it help? We have a little description of what some of these zoo activities, Tammy, can you tell us a little about that?
Hawaii Zoo is something that has come for the last several years to Columbia. They come to the school, they bring a variety of different animals. The kids do not touch the animals, they just learn about their different. You know, the different animal types and their different habitats, and following that activity, the teachers are going to do some hands-on activity in the gym, followed by, I believe they're gonna maybe do Madagascar or some animal-themed movie as a, for a treat for the kiddos in the afternoon.
Okay, thank you. Ryan, bicycle safety training, Rick.
Yeah, we had planned on doing that. We have not had a lot of response back from students, so we're still working on that.
Then cookies and canvas at the RMS and Sky Zone at RMS.
Chris Cox has put a lot of work into putting those two enrichment programs together. The cookies and canvas, the kids are going to sit down with a trained artist. They'll each have their own canvas and paints and brushes, and we'll follow along with the artist to create some kind of a zebra picture. She hasn't told us what that'll be yet. And then on Wednesday, April 1st, we'll hit some of our PE curriculum by going to Sky Zone. It's a center in Fort Wayne where there's like rooms full of trampolines. I guess it's pretty amazing. The kids are pretty excited about that. We've gotten quite a bit of feedback on that one.
Terry's from Fort Wayne and he's not even said.
Oh.
Don't recommend it for adults. About 2 minutes and you're done.
Did you have a bad experience, Terry?
No. I watched my kids do it and I saw a couple of adults and they lasted about 2 minutes. But I didn't waste the hour.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, everybody, for explaining those. Resignations, Bethany Roca, the speech and hearing therapist. Her last day will be March 13th, or was March 13th. Maternity leave, Lori Williams, March 21st through the end of the school year. And Samantha Williams, April 15th through the end of the school year. Any questions on the personnel report?
There's not one on there, but I did submit my resignation as a varsity paid coach for track and football, so it doesn't conflict my interest as a school board member. I'd still like to continue as a volunteer. I don't know if it's handled this time or later, but since we're approaching the track season very quickly, I just want to make it public that I have done so and have submitted that to Mr. Hill.
Okay. Thank you, Brad. Mm-hmm. If there's no more questions, I'll entertain a motion to accept the personnel report with Brad's addition.
I make a motion.
Okay, motion by Don.
I'll second.
Second by Jenny. All in favor, right hand, please. Okay, motion carries 6-0. The stipend for the culinary skills.
As we went into the hiring process for our food service director, Kathy Wilkinson, Sandy Tyler, and Lisa Lee sat on that committee, and if you'll recall, I think it was at the December board meeting, we talked about kind of dividing those processes with Kathy Wilkinson handling the budgetary items and the scheduling items, and then Vince using his culinary skills to work on the menu. At the time, I was reluctant to set a stipend for Vince in that we weren't exactly sure where that budget was. There were a lot of concerns with the transition. Sherry has spent a great deal of time with Kathy Wilkinson, and they have settled on $5,000 as a stipend. That still keeps us well within our former food service director. Those combined salaries are still very close to what we were offering before. We just tried to divvy up those responsibilities a little bit better to better service our students in that department. And Sandy was also part of that committee and those decisions, if she'd like to speak in regards to that. But I commend Sherry for working on that and Kathy, but we finally are starting to get a really good grasp on that food service budget and where we are and what we have to offer.
We are working on gardens.
Yes, yep. They're working on some gardening things that we can bring that directly to our students. Justin Pearson does some of that over at the high school with the ag department. We're looking at expanding on that in the elementaries and some of those areas. And they have some great ideas. We need to bring it to fruition, but this is another step in the right direction. And we needed to do a lot of alignment and getting that back on track. Kathy's also working on some policies and procedures that we'll be bringing to you so that we continue to build that department where it needs to be.
Any more questions? Need a motion to approve the stipend for the culinary skills, $5,000.
That would go to Vince Haynes.
For Vince.
I'll make that motion.
Okay, motion by Sandy. Second.
I'll second the motion.
Second by Brad. Any other questions? All in favor, right hand. Okay, motion carries 6-0. Hey, Terry, can you update us on the project?
And everybody should have. Terry provided us with the color code of the different greens. I'm not sure, Terry, why you chose green when we're black and white. You and I will talk about that.
It was a lot of work in Akron,
Yeah, we're going to talk about that a little bit later, but for now, we'll let you have the floor.
Okay, I'll try to. Yeah, that's what. I hope we're not here that This is an outline of bids that we received last week. We bid five projects, in which we had the study session. I reviewed some of those projects with you a while back, but we received two bids for Columbia projects, two bids for Riddle projects, and two bids for the high school as well. All but the electrical transformer project, those were all public bid projects. The electrical transformer project was private since it was under the $150,000 threshold. Not a great turnout bid wise, and bids were a little higher than I had hoped, but to explain some of that, we had got wind of Notre Dame bidding projects for the next 3 years, and I heard numbers between here and the moon, and
It's basically over $100 million worth of projects over the next 3 years at Notre Dame. So with that, contractors didn't bid. They're bidding those projects instead. So we're challenged by that a little bit. Of the bids we got, some of those bids were admittedly from those contractors after speaking with them a little higher because they're protecting themselves and they're not that hungry for the work. So unfortunately, the bids weren't quite as tight as I wanted them to be. But in the second column there, you have site would be the projects. The low bid were the low bids from the contractors. And as you can see from the other bids column, we only got one or two bids on every project, and that was it. Where last year we got five or six for every project. So,
and there were quite a few here for the pre-bid. We were excited about that aspect of it.
There were five or six contractors at the pre-bid meetings, and at least the first round, and had high expectations, and unfortunately just didn't get that many bids overall. The Columbia Air Handling Unit Fire Alarm and Gym Lighting Project, Herman and Goetz, was the only bid we received for that at $412,105. And then the interior finishes, Milestone Construction at $262,500. And as you can see there, Allen County Builders bid was a little higher on that project. Then Riddle Elementary, the same two projects as far as scope, Herman and Goetz at $152,184. And that was actually one that came in under our budget. Our projected budget from my AE team. And then the Milestone Construction interior finishes, again, that was $308,200. High school was the biggest one, which is the locker room renovation project and some HVAC work in there as well at $349,000. And in speaking with the contractors, was able to negotiate down some cost in these and without changing the scope drastically in any of them, because I prefer us to have a little more cushion. You can see the contingency amounts in the far right-hand column, and that's within that bid number. So that's money that's in there just in case we find unknowns and we start to tear something apart. So I think we're well protected, and overall, I think we're in good shape. We have a little work to do on Columbia to make sure that we're safe there, but otherwise, funding is still there and in place. And we're in the process right now of designing two more projects for exterior improvements in parking lot for the high school and for Riddle as well. So we have hope to have those out to bid in about a month.
Terry, do you mind going into a little more detail about the communications you've had with the contractor for
sure.
The high school?
Sure. The actual high school locker room bid came in at $460,000 last week. And that was off the chart compared to our budget. And so went through and I looked at what they had provided, which was limited as far as information regarding their bid. So I called them on Friday and spoke to them, and they outlined their subcontractors' information. EJ White, which actually did the mechanical in this building years ago, is their subcontractor, and about 90% of that project is MEP or HVAC work. So I asked them to give me a breakdown of their scope from their bid. And going through that scope, I realized there's stuff in there that made no sense to me at all. And I told them, no, we're not doing that, and that doesn't sound right. So this morning, I finally got them hooked up with our engineers. They reviewed the scope from the bid, reviewed the information in the drawings, and by, it was around 3 o'clock whenever I'd sent Jana the update, we took out $113,000 out of their bid with no change to the design whatsoever. It was misinterpretation, as they called it, on their part. And we'll leave it at that. So
are you comfortable and confident with that, though, moving forward?
I am. I actually spoke to Jim Swink as well, because Jim dealt with them here in the construction of this building and was very comfortable with working with them. And they were very helpful in dealing with some issues in this building after it was finished. So I'm comfortable in, after speaking with the contractor and basically getting them on the right track. And it took some convincing, but I did that this morning. And now I'm comfortable that it'll be a successful project and we'll be able to move forward. As my hope would be to get letters of intent out to them, allowing them to at least move forward with submittals, as the sooner we can get information from them regarding the equipment, the material, and those things that are in our drawings and specifications, and the sooner we can review that, hopefully approve it, they get it ordered, and they have it sitting waiting for the June 8th date to get moving on the projects and move forward. Because that's one of the big challenges over here is basically about a 6 week or so window for construction. The contractors have to have everything sitting and waiting. They go as fast as they can, and then they get out. And with all these five projects, except for the electrical transformer, we have liquidated damages in there. So if they're late and getting finished, then they incur $1,000 a day. So that also, in some cases, is incorporated into their bid because they're protecting themselves. So we're paying a little bit of premium for this, but in all these cases, they're in every hallway of Riddle. They're in every hallway of Columbia. They're in every gymnasium in Riddle and Columbia. We can't have them in there after school starts. It would be total chaos all over again, and we don't want to go through that. So in this case, it would be worse than last summer in the sense that it would be the entire building, except for the office.
Jim, you were at the meeting when we opened the bids and everything. Were you comfortable with the contractors and where we are and what's going on with projects?
And something to say about EJY, they did the plumbing and heating on the First Federal Saving. But we had problems with this building with the heating and cooling. And they're the ones that got everybody together to discuss the problem, not the architect, not the construction head. They're the ones that took the bull by the horns and had a big meeting with everybody one day just to get things straightened out.
So you're comfortable?
I'm very comfortable with EJY.
Thank you.
Any else? Any questions for Terry?
Will they have hot water in the locker room?
Sandy's asking about the hot water issue in the locker rooms.
Will they have hot water there?
They're going to have the hot water. I don't think is the biggest issue in there. The biggest issue is a lot of the showers don't work. They work properly, so all the showers will be completely renovated. And also the finishes, we're going to clean the showers, regrout them, clean the terrazzo. I decided to take it a few more steps than just fixing the water problem, and try to clean up the space to make those look a little nicer, because those are rough. Those the rest of the school looks phenomenal, but you walk in those showers and it's a little scary in there. So it's time for a little TLC to clean those up.
Do you have comments, Mr. Weaver?
I will leave it with Mr. Thornsbury, but I concur. Yes.
I don't think anything's been done since school's built, have they? Jim, do you know?
I think a little bit, not much.
And it's a new school, so.
Yeah.
Tom, okay, would you want to just confirm where the funding sources for these projects come from so that everybody who's here and is sure they know what's going on?
It's part of the $8 million bond that you got last year. This is the rest of that money is coming from there.
And question for you, Sherry, just for the record, and tell me if I'm wrong here, because I usually am. We've allocated $2 million for each building, so to speak. Where that $2 million goes, it has to be spent, because if we don't spend it, it can hurt us in the future, correct?
Right. You only have $2 million to stay under a controlled bond. So each building gets $2 million.
And
really,
where
after all your fees and stuff come out, it's like 1.93 something. But yeah, each building has its own set thing.
But Mr. Thornsbury, in conjunction with Mr. Swank and Mrs. Vance, went through and looked and saw what we needed, and we have to spend that money, otherwise we run into issues.
Me and Mrs. Vance and Terry went through and made sure that before we went to bid that everything was in line and that we had enough to cover all these in each building.
I know that. I just want to make sure the public knows, so we're all above board on it.
And Jim, you're comfortable with the projects as outlined, that those are needs and...
Good question, Brad.
Thanks.
Will this be complete then, those three bonds? We know the middle school one is already completed.
Once we finish the exterior projects in about a month, yes, I believe it will be down to just a little bit left that will be spent on small projects within buildings themselves.
And that would be something we would work with our own maintenance and building leaders. It wouldn't necessarily involve Terry for those last funds to be spent in the bond project.
So once completed, it looks like we're going to get a little bit more for our money than we originally thought from savings on the bids.
I think so. We had a little better luck last round than this round. Once I negotiated a few of these things and got a few things cleaned up, I think we'll be in good shape and end up getting good projects. Because all the things that are in these projects are well needed, and there are many things beyond that, but at least we make a good dent inside the buildings now. on some things that a lot of public things are going to see. The people have been in the high school gymnasium since we did that lighting project. Now you're going to see it in all the, in both Redwood and Columbia as well. New LED lighting and new carpet in the hallways. And so they're good viewable projects for the public to be able to see and actually understand where some of this money's going, because when we're fixing a roof and we're putting equipment up on the roof, nobody gets to see it except for Jim, so.
Okay, well, thank you, Derek. Good job. Okay, we've had a chance to look at the bids. Have a motion to go ahead. Time is kind of critical. Like Terry has mentioned, suppliers need to get things lined up and going. Any more questions or?
Terry, are you recommending that these be accepted, because there are several of them that were unchallenged, there's no competing bid. Are you thinking that we should accept some and throw some others out or redo this or anything?
I actually spoke to, for instance, because I didn't know where we were going to stand on the locker room project as of this morning when I first started. So I called and talked to Milestone, and I have a good relationship with them, and asked them, okay, if I put this back out to bid, will you go after that project? And I would also talk to Herman and Getz and ask them to go after it. And he was reluctant because he said they're so busy and he doesn't want to bite off more than he can chew with these deadlines and knowing he has a short window of opportunity over here. And I personally contacted quite a few contractors on these projects and expected them to bid, but one after another, they dropped out. And it was because there's just so much out there right now. And it's just, the competition, it has changed a lot in the last year, and I don't know that we would get any better results or viable bids. We might save a little bit of money, but by even extending this another 2 to 3 weeks would put us beyond the schedule we were on last year, and we barely got done. Because there are the doors and fiberglass panels for those doors, that's a 12-week lead time. So we barely got it into the building in time before the deadline. And so I would be very concerned to push that. Unfortunately, I wasn't happy either that we didn't get competition between the projects, because that's the nature of this. And I think the high school locker room project was an example of what might have happened there had I not gone through that process this morning to kind of do the checks and balance, because it didn't seem right.
So. And then correct me if I'm wrong, but as we go through this, we also have to spend the bond money within a certain period of time. There has to be continued progression with the bond funds. So we need to continue to move forward and spend those funds as outlined here.
The bid for the Columbia fire alarm and gym lighting, that's the single most expensive or costly thing on the page. Is that within the ballpark of what you expected?
It was probably roughly between $40,000 and $50,000 higher, but the Riddle one was about $30,000 lower than I anticipated. So I'm not sure what Herman Getz is doing there, but it seems to be a numbers game, because he offered, I'll just ship the money over there. And I said, no, you can't do that. And tried to explain to him, you can't. Yeah, and I said, no. I tried to explain some of it to him, but it's not what they're looking at. So. That one, a little bit, but that one has quite a bit of work involved in that project. We're doing air handling units in the gymnasium. We're also doing lighting in those spaces and a complete new fire alarm system that is going to take you off of a simplex system, which you're kind of stuck in right now, that will free up Jim a little bit and some other opportunities down the road.
Okay, one other question. Is this three-year construction deal up in Notre Dame, is that going to be a continuous bidding thing, or is the bidding going to be over at a certain time and the companies will know they're not getting work or are getting work there? I mean, we got to run into this for the next 3 years.
It sounds like we're going to run into this for the next 3 years.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
And that doesn't, because the contractors I had in Fort Wayne lined up Hagerman, which has done a lot of work over here, they dropped it. They were going to bid all five of them. And they needed another week to bid because of their bid schedule. And I told them that I gave them 2 days, but I couldn't give them a whole week. And they dropped out. And everyone else I contacted in Fort Wayne was in the same boat, and Fort Wayne Community Schools just bid three projects, which totaled probably roughly $20 million, about the same time we were doing this. So just a lot of stuff out there, a lot of money being spent. And so these, the pencils aren't sharp anymore, and they're padding things a little bit to try to, you know, make sure if they get it, then they're gonna make some money off of it. But the way that Herman and Getz explained this to me was, he said, I'm gonna have seven guys at Columbia, and I'm gonna have seven guys at Riddle for 5 to 6 weeks straight, or I could have those 14 guys at Notre Dame on a much bigger project. And it does make sense. So they're making up some of that in these bid numbers.
All right, thank you. Simple support.
And the problem with trying to open bids again, there would be no guarantee you'd get any more bids. And no. Maybe even lose the ones you have.
Terry and I have to go through the process of putting public notices out. That takes a few weeks. Time. And then we have to accept bids within a certain time period of those notices. And then to go through this process again, to get to receive the bids, review them, get them to you for review and approval. At that point, we would be weeks beyond where we were last year in order to get everything to come together. So, and in the end, we may not be any better off than we were.
There's no fencing in these bids, right? Is that something we're taking care of in a different way?
Yeah, we're taking care of that. It's Terry isn't in charge of that project, but the funds would be part of that.
The expenses and I have to go to the public bid or anything.
But we are seeking competitive bids on that. Right. It's just not enough that Terry is involved in it. And those fences, we do plan on putting fences in around Columbia and Riddle as part of the safety initiative as well.
Okay, we're entertaining a motion to accept the bids for this project in round two.
Make a motion
that
we accept these bids.
Okay, motion by Sandy. Have a second.
I'll second.
Second by Brett. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand. Motion carries 6-0. Thank you. Okay. This time we have a section we're going to have community concerns. Mr. Wagner is here and we'd like to talk a little bit. If you could just state your name, address. We'd like to limit this to like 3 minutes, if you could, please.
Yeah, it's just my concern, sir. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you for the minutes. I appreciate it. I received a letter from signed by Ms. Janet Vance. This is unfortunately not as fun as the other stuff that has been talked about. I apologize for that. But my kids were going to shoot baskets over behind the middle school on Sunday, 36 degrees, sunny day. And when they got there, Mrs. Vance and Mr. Doherty's vehicles were parked underneath the basketball hoop, so we asked them if they would move it. And they said no, and I asked why, and got into a discussion of one thing or another. And I said, well, but these kids want to shoot baskets. They're 12 and 7 years old. Can they shoot baskets? This is the school that they go to that their parents pay taxes for. And they were adamant about it. He said, no. They said they were renting space for some event and that they had a right to park wherever they wanted to park. He said, fine. You just move the vehicles 4 car spaces over here so the kids can shoot baskets there. And they refused. And it seems to me to be, I think it's at least an abuse of power. But we've been here for 7 months. We just live over here and the kids ride their bikes here and they skateboard over here. They don't damage any property. They have fun. Not a whole lot to do in the town. But I could tell you that there's been, I don't know, No, I do know. Seven. I've got like this letter, for example, this letter was put in an envelope. But it wasn't mailed. It was walked over and delivered to our front door by Mr. Doherty. Show of authority. Here's your letter. And I could have put it in the mailbox, but he didn't. Which is fine. And actually, you know, actually, Ian isn't even to go shoot baskets over where he was when he was doing it. The snow's gone, so he can go to the park, which Mrs. Vance suggested, except that there was a foot of snow on there. But from now on, you know, for the summer, yeah, he can go over there. It's all good. Audrey likes to ride her bike through the parking lot over to O'Reilly's and back. And I end up having to go with her, which is fun. I like doing it. But her and I also wake up earlier than the other two. And so on Saturday mornings, we go over to the tennis courts and we hit the ball, which we can't do now according to this letter. We're not supposed to step ground, step foot on the property of the schools, which we don't know the property lines, but we'll abide by it. But it seems that there's, I don't know if it's a culture of administrative abuse, and I don't even know to what degree is an abuse of bulliness, and I don't like throwing that word out. But if you read the letter, if anyone's interested in it, you get the last sentence saying that our family may be allowed to come back on the property if we obey the instructions of school personnel. We have to obey the instructions of authority. And I teach my kids, I said, there's two things you need to do with authority. One, you have to respect. To respect everyone, so that's not that big of a thing. But the second thing you do with authority is you question. Because there's three people you do have to abide by, or to obey. You have to obey your mother, you have to obey your dad, and you have to obey the law. The problem is, the authority makes the law. So you have to question that. You can disagree with it, you can agree with it, but you have to show respect to it. And this sentence that says you must obey the instructions is another sentence of I fear that it's, I don't know what to say about it. I used my 3 minutes up. I appreciate the time. If anybody has any questions, I'm probably not.
Did you have more to say? I mean,
yeah, but yeah. I only have 3 minutes, so it's all good. And maybe I'll say some stuff later or whatever. But thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, sure.
Anybody else like to address the concerns? Okay. Next item, superintendent business.
Jim shared today that the bollards will be going in from Brooks Concrete. Is that correct? That's part of the safety initiative that was spoken about. The bollards go in front of each of the buildings that we can put flower arrangements, those types of things in. So over spring break.
Yeah, just to let you know, this was spoken to last spring, but because of the fact that all the schools were going to have their front entrances worked on, we decided to pull them back and wait until everything was finished so we can go in there and try not to disturb as much as possible. They'll start those over spring break. I've emailed all the principals to see their schedules and the buildings and stuff, and Brooke says they will work around everybody. So they shouldn't have to, we shouldn't have a problem with intercession or anything like that.
In addition, I would like to talk to the board about the pool and would recommend that we make a motion. I've been working with Mark Smith at Smith Sawyer and Smith, and we have talked a lot about opening the pool up for public swim, part of that being an initiative with the running club and the triathlon that they are going to have this summer. But then I've had others inquire about being able to continue with the open swim. Mark has shared with me that as long as we have a lifeguard on duty and a supervisor, school personnel, that it will not be an increase to the cost of our insurance at this point in time. So I would like to make a motion, or ask the board to make a motion, that we try open swim for the pool in conjunction with the request from the running club in regards to the triathlon. They had set aside about 5 or 6 weeks' time that they would like to do that. They believe the cost to be around $3 per person, and we would like to do that kind of as a pilot and trial run, and then go back and revisit how that looks with lifeguards, with school personnel, those types of things, with the supervision, and then look at the possibility of continued open swims if there are no incidents and the insurance is willing to continue to carry us beyond that at no additional charge.
Any questions?
So, would the school corporation be in charge of hiring the lifeguard and collecting the money, or the
running club?
The running club would hire the lifeguard, so the money would flow through that. So, if there were more people than at $3 a person, and they made a profit on that, that would be part of their profit. If they were at a deficit, that would be their.
They would have to cover the cost of are the lifeguard, the cost of the supervision, the cost of, we have the chemicals, those types of things all outlined, and they would pay that cost. And then what they raise above that would be their funds for the running club and the triathlon that they're doing.
So this right now is just a
they have requested it as a facility use for that period of time, which would involve an open swim by the public. And then we're hoping after that period of time, if it goes well, to continue with open swim for the public, and then we would have to do the scheduling and supervision of those things.
What is the school's official relationship with the running club? Is it sponsored, chartered, or just allowed? Or
we talked about sponsored and chartered, and that was part of the facility use with policies and procedures, and I'm not sure that we've ever gotten to that point.
I mean,
at this time,
something that was very dear to Bob, that we just, that any club that, you know, be chartered, mm-hmm. at least be chartered. It takes nothing, it's a piece of paper, you know, that needs to be filled out.
And I think at this point they'd be just like any other group that wants to rent the facility. So
this isn't the running club, like Charlie's running club, correct?
No.
This
no.
is
no.
this
no, no,
is
no.
the triathlon group. Mm-hmm. Scott Stelbaum probably
right,
in charge
Scott's
of it.
And yeah. they do the triathlon. Do they call it the Manitou
Monster?
Manitou
Monster. So they're not a school club, just like any other thing requesting.
Well, there's, I'm sorry, there's been other things that they do that school related, just not official. In the past, besides the triathlon, mm-hmm. it's a school-related activity without being official. Like, for instance, if there's other events that our Rochester kids run at that we can't go officially as the Zebras, it's the Rochester's Running Club. Mm-hmm. And so there has been a relationship. I guess that's just what I was pointing out. It's not just some group coming in. It's
right.
kind of an involved group.
Mm-hmm. Is it only students? I'm sorry. Is it only? I know that it's obviously not only students who are running the triathlon, but is it only students that are in the running club then? As far as you know.
My understanding of what they're asking for the pool is it's not just only students that would be doing it. Adults could participate in the triathlon as well, and so they would be opening it up to adults, anybody who's running the triathlon.
Can we ask them to fill out the charter before they start?
We can.
And the next thing I have on that agenda, like for youth football, involves mostly Rochester children. We carry $1 million liability policy. I realize it's a stupid pool we do as well. Does the running club carry this as well, or?
Mark was working with them in regards
okay.
to that.
Okay.
Because at one time they were trying to decide if it were best to run it through the running club or run it through the Royals, but it really is a running club.
Right.
activity.
I just want it to be consistent and fair across the board.
Okay.
Well, speaking of consistent chartering, though, does the youth football...
So you require that for them?
Is the youth football chartered or anything like that? So it's a charter, okay, so that would be analogous to the running.
But also, in interest of liability, not only protect ourselves from a youth football coach, but as a school board, we carry through, and this isn't an advertisement, but through Farm Bureau, we carry $1 million liability policy, regardless of what the school has. And I just feel more comfortable with that as a school board member now than we do that consistently for anybody that wants to use that.
Yeah, anybody that rents the facility has to show proof of insurance over a central office, so...
And I would think the running club with the Manitoba Monster would have liability.
I would think so.
When you run a big public event like that.
But you know how to, you don't want to assume anything, of course.
Yeah, maybe just a day policy.
But I think that's something we need to continue to work on, that I think probably got dropped with Bob, is filling out, making sure everybody had a charter relationship or...
Because all that was it just, it gave us an idea of who was doing what.
And we got a form they can fill out?
Uh-huh, yeah, it's one sheet.
So you want this to be like a trial period, and we'll revisit it in a year or less?
Well, I would say after we get through the triathlon, then if it works out well and the entrance is willing to continue at no additional charge, then the public has shown a lot of interest in renting the pool at different times. And it's open, we have it running, we have it filled, we have the chemicals going. If we can be of service to the community, I think that would be a good thing. So this would be just during the proposal that the running club turned in. I think it was a 5 or 6 week, do you recall, Linda? It was 5 or 6 weeks in regards to the training for that specific activity.
Okay. Any more questions?
They were looking at $3 a person, which was going to be enough to cover, they felt cover everything.
I guess there is, and you mentioned that, would they would give money for chemicals and things like that?
Yeah, they would cover the cost. It would be just as when we rent out the facility or whatever. There is a cost to cover custodial care, the lighting. I know that they are working on a policy with the lights in the gym or the cafeteria, those types of things. So they would have to encumber that cost.
Sure. I just want, like I said, I want it to be consistent across all groups. I think it's great they can use the facility, but I want it to be consistent on how we keep treat people too.
We're trying.
Sure.
Okay. Any more on that?
No, not on that.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to approve the running club use the pool.
I'll make that motion.
Okay, Don made a motion. Have a second?
I'll second it.
Second by Jenny. Enter discussion. All in favor, right hand, please. Motion carries 6-0.
I'll get with Scott tomorrow in regards to the charter. Additionally, I know you had approved the teachers and the IAs for enrichment and intercession. Report cards come home this Wednesday, and I would encourage parents as they see those and review those, if there's continued concern and they want to enroll them in intercession, please make sure that they get a hold of the building level principal so that we continue to grow those numbers. And then finally, at 4 o'clock today, Linda heard me hipping and hollering down the hallway. We got our okay from the state to extend times to look at adjusting our calendar. So I have put out a conversation with Alex Lute in regards to our the Classroom Teachers Association, RCTA, and working with Dan McCarthy in regards to a survey. I've already let building level principals know that they need to start looking at different schedules depending upon how that survey goes. Transportation, I met with them this afternoon very informally right at the end of the day, and Kathy's on board for food service, so I think we're ready to roll it out. There's a lot of pros and cons and regarding that survey that I'd like for people to remember. Some are asking for Saturdays, and just to keep in mind as you're thinking through and filling out that surveys, if we do Saturdays, it seems to be a less, it's over sooner for teachers and students, but we have to keep in mind there are a lot of athletic events on the weekends, a lot of baseball, track, tennis type tournaments, so a lot of athletes, jobs. We worry about parents who may share custody of children going back and forth on the weekend, so we have to be very careful with that. If we were to do the extended day, we are working with transportation that we could provide additional bus routes so that students aren't on the bus any longer. We would shorten those routes and those pickup times. We could provide snacks at the end of the day. But the whole purpose, no matter what we do, is to try to add that instructional time before we have to finish the state testing and complete that. We want to get as much instructional time as we can before that date and time. So we are working on that, and I ask parents to start looking for that survey, and if the Sentinel can help us, and Channel 4 getting that information out. Are you going to link that to our home webpage? Is that where they can find the survey?
Yeah, I can put the link to that on our homepage.
And we're meeting as a tech department tomorrow morning anyway, so we'll finish that and get that out to the public and start rolling out what that would look like. The other option is to continue on just day by day. We have, we've missed 8 days. We have 2 built into the calendar. We can look at Saturdays. We can look at extended times, or we can look at carrying this into the second week of June, which is where we would essentially be with those dates in. So we'll outline those options and then try to do what's best for the community as a whole in regards to that, but we're ready to move forward.
Have we successfully, I think, explained to the community e-learning?
We are going to an e-learning conference in April. We're taking a team of administrators. Loretta's going, the tech department's going, Alex Lewis is going to send a representative. There are still a lot of questions and concerns, and even people within our own district who may have students in other districts with e-learning. There are a lot of questions around people who may not have Wi-Fi at home, how to provide the instruction for those particular students. There's a lot of concern about if they send students to daycare, is the daycare now responsible for providing that instruction during the course of the day? If a student has an IEP, how are we going to make sure that we make all of the accommodations and adjust for their learning needs? The state has said just simply sending home packets of worksheets does not suffice, so we want to make sure that we're in compliance with what they're doing. So it's much more than just sending a computer home. We have to make sure we're meeting the standards. We have to make sure that we're in compliance with those things. And I feel like we have a lot of work ahead of us. There are some schools who have said they've done 4 or 5 e-learning days, and they feel like the data is showing that the students are falling behind, and so we want to make sure that we're not doing that. I've had other parents share with me that the work that was presented to them probably wasn't sufficient for what was needed. So we want to make sure when we do this that we're going to do it correctly, and we're going to engage in those conversations and try to roll it out next year.
Now, the extended day option, that'd be similar to what we did last year.
It would be very similar. Linda and I were working on this after school. We actually have an extra day that we need to make up. Last year, the school district missed more days, but the state actually waived days completely. This year, they're not wavering any of the days. They're just allowing us to adjust the time. So last year, they needed to make up 5 days in the end. This year, we're looking at having to make up 6 total days. We've missed 8. We have 2 built into the calendar, so we need to make up the hours, the minutes, for 6 days this year. So essentially, if we decided to extend the day, the quick math at the end of the day was that we would start this immediately after spring break, and it would carry right through to the end of the school year. We would be really close there that last week. So if we get a delay or a cancellation, we would have to adjust accordingly, but we do have time to get it in. But we will send the survey out. We're not saying extended days right now. We want to get public input and support, but there are a lot of concerns. No matter what we do, it's not families are going to have to adjust one way or the other. But we did get the approval to move forward.
Have we looked at having a combination, you know, like, because we have 6, do we do 3 that first week of June and 3 extended, you know,
the those equivalent of 3 extended days? Those were things that we were going to put on the survey, different options that we could
like
make
you said,
work.
None of that is a perfect option, but.
Those are things that we talked about. And then we also talked about moving forward as we adopt calendars, maybe looking at this time with spring break to adjust it to be very similar to like a fall break so that those makeup days are right there within the calendar and we would have that flexibility to use it in the future. But I think that's all I have.
Any more questions? Board have any comments? Steve?
With this one? On the bus? No.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Any questions or comments from the audience? If not, we'll adjourn the meeting. Thank you for coming.